Good morning and welcome, everybody. My name is Marjorie Kuhn. I currently serve on AJC's National Board of Governors, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this morning's AJC University session. I'd especially like to welcome the viewers tuning into our global webcast. The rise of ISIS, otherwise known as the Islamic State, ISIL, or Daesh, probably didn't pronounce that correctly, forgive me, has undoubtedly been the most astonishing and unexpected international story of our generation. Who could have imagined that a ragtag gang of extremist Muslims with dreams of establishing a caliphate and bringing down the West would be able to capture and control large swaths of Iraq and Syria and generate satellite groups of marauders elsewhere in the Middle East and Africa? It was not long ago, after all, that intelligent, informed people, not least among them President Barack Obama, was discrediting the threat posed by ISIS. Recently, reports suggest that the territorial advances of ISIS have stalled, and that the borders of territory under the control of this non-state behemoth are slowly receding. Even so, it will likely take many years to oust ISIS from its strongholds, where it kills, rapes, and forcibly converts the inhabitants and requires everyone to live by its strict Islamic code. This self-proclaimed caliphate, by dint of geography and its extreme hatred for the Jewish people, must also be considered an imminent threat to Israel. ISIS has already arrived on Israel's northern border with Syria. But for Jordan, it would be on Israel's eastern flank as well. Even in other parts of the world, terrorists inspired by ISIS are active. Many young European Muslims travel to the Middle East to train with ISIS and then return to their home countries to wreak havoc, bloodshed, and destruction. Attacks in Paris, San Bernardino, and Brussels have made it clear that ISIS poses a real danger, not just within the collapsing states of Iraq and Syria, but also in Europe and here at home. We have with us today a panel of noted experts on the nature of ISIS, its goals and strategies, and the nature of the response mounted by the West. Here to offer their insights and take your questions are Ronen Bergman, senior correspondent for military and intelligence affairs for the Israeli daily, Yedioth Ahronoth. Thank you very much, a little assist. Will McCants, director of the project on US relations with the Islamic world at the Brookings Institution. Saad Amrani, chief commissioner of the Brussels Police Department, and our moderator, Jason Isaacson, AJC's Assistant Executive Director for Policy. Please welcome them now.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Marjorie. About 10 weeks ago, after the horrific terrorist attacks in the Brussels airport and subway station, President Obama sought to reassure an anxious American public. Among the president's remarks at a press conference in Argentina were this: "There's no more important item on my agenda than going after them and defeating them. The issue is, how do we do it in an intelligent way?" The president added, "We defeat them in part by saying, you are not strong, you are weak. We send a message to those who might be inspired by them to say you are not going to change our values." I think we can start this morning's discussion by stipulating the immense challenge of wiping out ISIS without, as well, wiping out thousands of innocent civilians. And we can also stipulate that there have been battlefield successes against ISIS, that the territory it controls in Syria and Iraq has shrunk by about 20% in the last 16 months, according to reports. That said, it is nothing short of intolerable that millions of people in Syria and Iraq, including especially vulnerable and routinely victimized religious and ethnic minorities, continue to live under the yoke of ISIS domination, and that the group still commands what is variously estimated at 30,000 to 40,000 fighters, a large percentage of them from other countries outside of Syria and Iraq, and that there are ISIS cells and or ISIS sympathizers in Europe, elsewhere in the Middle East and in North Africa and across the globe, including in the Americas. I'd like to start by asking our panelists this morning about President Obama's statements of March. Are we, the U.S. and the multilateral coalition that the U.S. leads, going after ISIS in, quote, an intelligent way? Is the message that we're sending, that they are not strong, that they are weak, getting across to recruits and potential recruits? Are we actually winning this long war? And I think, Will, I'd like to start with you.
Sure. Thank you for having me. To answer the question, it helps to look at where ISIS came from. This is an organization that declared itself a state in 2006. It was widely ridiculed because it controlled no territory. The U.S. Army, in combination with the Iraqi government and local Arab tribes, were able to defeat it as an insurgency in 2008. Just 5 years later, it came roaring back as a consequence of the U.S. military drawdown in Iraq and the descent of Syria into civil war. And it was able to build a state that controlled, by some estimates, 8 million people and a war chest of $2 billion. This was the situation that the United States and the coalition confronted in 2014 after the organization took Mosul, Iraq's second largest city, and declared itself the caliphate, or the return of the early Islamic empire. Since then, the United States and its coalition has been able to claw back some 30 to 40% of the organization's territory, depending on which estimates you're looking at. And I would say in Iraq and Syria, the strategy is about as good as it gets unless the United States or another powerful nation is willing to put large numbers of troops on the ground. And in this country, there are major political constraints on that action. On neither side of the aisle is that sort of troop commitment being contemplated. So at the moment, given the political constraints in this country, the lack of willing partners in the Middle East, this is about as good as it gets.
Saad, let me turn to you. Are the battlefield victories that Will is talking about translating into signals that maybe discourage recruitment of ISIS fighters or those who want to sign up for this glorious battle?
Well, I took good note of your question, but I would like to put it in perspective, in a global perspective. When President Obama was on TV a few years ago announcing proudly to the public that bin Laden has been eliminated, everybody thought this is party time, okay? The minute he finished his speech, we started having a much bigger problem that has started to brew. So why am I saying that? Is that I think we will defeat ISIS, ultimately. Nobody can put a date on that. It can be next year, can be in a couple of years. It will happen. But it's not. There's no reason to celebrate. Because when ISIS will be finished, we will be left with thousands of fighters or recruits that have had extensive military experience and going back to Europe or going back to Australia or even to the United States. And then we will be facing a much bigger problem. So as you're stating your question, I'm already thinking ahead about the next step, which worries me actually much more than the issue of ISIS right now. The second comment is that we have, unfortunately, for the last years, been dealing with these questions as if they were questions that appeared ex nihilo, like technical questions. Okay, we have a group. They're conducting terrorist activities. We will arrest them, prosecute them, or eliminate them. Actually, we have forgotten to take care about what I call the software, which is the ideology, the utopia that is actually the breeding ground for these youngsters that you have mentioned, who are trying to be, who are attracted to this, some discourse, some speeches, and we will continue to be so. So when ISIS, for example, will be defeated, it's going to be much worse. I'm going to tell you why. Because ISIS, for the first time after the end of the caliphate in the Ottoman Empire, has offered to the Muslim world another utopia, which is very attractive. And when the coalition, so to speak, defeats ISIS, the Muslim world, at least a part of it, not the whole, all of it, it's very bad to generalize in general, will be disappointed because to a certain level, people have been attracted in general, not only recruits or potential recruits, by what I would call the common reference framework that ISIS is using. If you take a John Doe Muslim, you know, mainstream Muslim, old, young, woman, man, whatever, at some point in their life, they have heard in their education certain words and concepts that ISIS is using in their magazines. I would recommend anyone, you know, to read the magazines of ISIS. I'm not making a publicity, but it's just to understand, you know, the rationality and the technique and the media strategy, which is outstanding, that they are using. Put yourself in the shoes of the young man who is, in some cases, unfortunately, intellectually disequipped in some rundown neighborhoods, like in Molenbeek, for example, in Brussels. But mind you, there are lots of Molenbeeks around the world, and certainly in France. In France, they have like 400 Molenbeeks. They have not materialized in terms of activities and so forth up until now, but it will just unfortunately happen in the near future. So that software, just to finalize this first answer, will be there. And people will be disappointed. They will think, okay, at some point we have dreamt, you know, irrationally about some form of caliphate, some form of land where we could practice our religion and so forth, and the coalition has taken it away from us. And there will be somebody else, there will be other groups, remember that will take over from ISIS in the next 2 to 3 years.
So battlefield victories are not going to
battlefield victories are not enough. I will just add one comment, if you don't mind. I've started a program of exchange with the Moroccan police. Moroccan police is really doing well in fighting terrorism and radicalization. Even their program has been recognized by the United Nations. So they came to Brussels, we visited them, and they came to Brussels a couple of weeks ago. And they have outlined, you know, their strategy. Their strategy is threefold. First, the repressive aspect, judicial criminal investigation. That's common sense. The second one is socioeconomic approach, actually to work on the Molenbeeks that they have also in Morocco and so forth, to make sure that the breeding ground is not fertile enough for some weak-minded, you know, people to actually embrace this kind of philosophy. And the third one, and this is one of the messages I would like to pass today, and they said, if you don't approach the religious aspect, they call it la restructuration du champ religieux, the restructuring of the religious field. If you don't address that question, the rest of what you do is like useless. This is food for thought, maybe.
Thank you.
For the next question.
Ronen, I'd like to pick up with you. First of all, your thoughts on whether we are or not winning this or having some success in this long war. But secondly, you wrote in a column in March, I believe, just after the Brussels attacks, that Europe would need to adopt security proposals similar to Israel's with a greater degree of intrusiveness than has been the tradition if it's truly to defend itself against terror. Do you see any evidence that Europe is taking that advice? To what degree is Israel sharing its methodology, its concepts of how to approach terror with European partners?
Thanks. First, on the question of whether the West is winning. So far, I think the West is not winning. There are some tactical successes, as my colleague here mentioned, but ISIS is still there. ISIS is controlling a land. And controlling a land is not just a symbol of having a caliphate, as mentioned here, but is also a base from which you can launch attacks against the West. And now we know from intelligence that many of the attacks in Brussels, in Paris, in other places, were at least coordinated from the what is called the Committee for Intelligence and Special Operations of Al-Qaeda based in Iraq and Syria. Now, I think that most of the West has drawn a lesson from the American and international intervention in Iraq and in Afghanistan, which evolved to a DNA in the West that opposes any kind of military intervention everywhere. I think leading that school of thought is the man sitting in the White House, which really objects, and we know what happened in Syria. Every red line, including the use of chemical weapon, was crossed, and yet the United States did not react. And that backfired in the creation, as was said by my colleague, that backfired in the creation of a very strong ISIS. I think that the first lesson that the first phase, or the lesson from the first phase of the intervention in Afghanistan was lost, was forgotten. it was launched, the attack on Afghanistan was launched to destroy the bases of Al-Qaeda following September 11. And in that sense, it was a success. The sinking into the quicksand of Afghanistan afterwards is another political question, and it is a problem. But after the United States was able to destroy Al-Qaeda bases in Afghanistan, the whole organization disassembled throughout the Middle East, and it made it very, very easy for the United States to defeat Al-Qaeda, to trace down and assassinate the targeted killing, the core of Al-Qaeda, which led at the mid of the last decade, the withdrawal of Al-Qaeda to the Middle East. I think that as many piles and as many bodies are being piled at the streets of Europe, we are getting, and this is related to your second question, we are getting close to, I would say, a three-step, three measures that needs to be taken or might be taken by the Europeans, and they are extremely reluctant to take them now. The first is to change completely the regime of mass transportation. Airports, seaports, train stations, not just the vehicle itself, not just the airplane, as was done after September 11, but the whole hemisphere of the station itself, the whole proximity. We know today that there are strong suspicion that the booby trap can that was put aboard the Russian airplane and took it down by Al-Qaeda together with the Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis, the Al-Qaeda, Sinai Providence Al-Qaeda branch in Sinai, was apparently delivered by a Al-Qaeda recruit among the Egyptian workers in Sharm el-Sheikh airport. Now, if this is true, yet to be proven, but if this is true, then you should think of a new regime for airplane and mass transportation worldwide. That's the first. The second is to adopt some of the methods that were developed by the Israeli Domestic Internal Secret Service, the Shin Bet, against suicide bombing since the mid-90s until they defeated suicide bombing in 2004. These measures require harming civil rights and deliver such a message, deliver such a legal, profound change is very hard for Europe, especially for Germany, for obvious reasons. They are not ready for it now, but if, and I hope it won't happen, but if terrorism continues in Europe, these measures are going to be taken. And last step, if this doesn't help, then Europe would need to have a boots on the ground attack against ISIS in Syria and Iraq. And I think when this happens, it would be proven that ISIS is far less strong than it is considered to be. These are 40,000 people on a Toyota pickup. They are nothing in direct confrontation with a strong military force.
Whose boots? Will, you want to pick up on that?
Yeah. European and U.S. That's going to be it.
Will?
Well, that's right. That's the dilemma. Whose boots are they going to be? You're absolutely right that if a major world military went in, ISIS would be crushed. There's no question that it would be crushed. But the dilemma is, what do you do in the aftermath? I mean, I'm mindful of the fact in the prior decade that the United States had over 100,000 troops in Iraq and only managed to defeat the insurgency, did not defeat the organization, which remained one of the world's most powerful terror organizations, even when it was defeated. Politically, I don't see it in the cards. We may have to come to it, given developments on the ground in Syria and Iraq, but it's hard to see at the moment. It's hard to see regional allies doing anything about it, not because they're not worried about ISIS, but it's because they all have different priorities than the Western nations. If you look at Turkey, which has one of the more capable militaries in the region, it's more worried about the Kurds. I mean, it was allowing ISIS fighters to transit across the border because it was hoping that it would stop the Kurds from establishing a state in northern Syria. Saudi Arabia, another US partner in the region, is more obsessed with Iran. So you have a system of partnerships and alliances that have different priorities than some of the Western countries. compounded by the fact that you have a region, the Middle East and North Africa, that is in free fall. If we were talking about one country or two countries with civil wars, we could bring the weight of the international community to bear on the conflict and bring about some resolution. But you have four or five raging at the same time, and ISIS is going, and other groups are going to be able to move in and exploit those security vacuums, to say nothing of the vacuum, the security vacuum that they find in Europe. And my colleague Saad is better capable to speak to this, but it strikes me that Europe moves so quickly to create a political unity without fashioning the mechanisms for policing itself. And we are seeing the consequences of that, not just with the refugees, but also with terrorism. So there are security vacuums, not just in the Middle East and North Africa, but are in Europe as well, that are going to take years to shore up. It's not just about the appeal of the ideology. It's also that you have to have a capable security infrastructure to handle these threats, and they're not present.
Thank you. So Saad, let me come back to you, talking about the security infrastructure in Europe, specifically in Belgium, of course. But I'd also like to get back to something that we were talking about earlier, you and I, about the social ingredients that create opportunities for ISIS recruitment.
Right.
And what can be done in European societies, and maybe start with your own country.
Okay, first of all, I would like to bounce back on what he said. He's absolutely right to point out that lots of countries or political actors are not ready yet to take the necessary steps, actually to secure, you know, the European public, so to speak. We've talked a couple of days, you and I, you know, about the denial. While some political actors are still in some form of denial. You know, before it was total denial, which has led us, you know, to the situation in which we found ourselves today. Now I would say after Paris and Brussels, they are in some form of light version of denial. Okay, Brussels has taken, that is correct. Belgium has taken the first steps, you know, in the direction to what you said. So for example, Brussels Airport took my flight, you know, in Brussels a few days ago, has completely changed. There are different security steps, different perimeters just outside the airport, and guess who contributed to actually design this new perimeter securities, security perimeters? It's actually the guy who designed the Ben-Gurion Airport in Tel Aviv. He was in Brussels a few weeks ago, and thanks very much to him, to his contribution. It has woken up a lot of people with regard to that aspect. Is it taking place in the rest of Europe? Of course not. There are some blind spots in different parts of our transportation system that are still weak. Just to follow up on what you said as well, suppose we secure airports, transportation means, and so forth. Is that enough, you know, for actually countering the terrorist attacks? I can tell you no, because they are extremely creative. If you secure airports and airplanes and boats and so forth, they will just hit other, what we call the soft targets. And believe me, there are thousands of them. And we can talk about it for many hours. So if you see it from a police standpoint, loopholes or weak points are countless. Going back to the second part of your question, it's actually related to what has been said a few minutes ago. Once again, may I insist on that aspect. Every step that we will take with regard to defeating those kind of groups, be it ISIS or Al-Qaeda, on the field, with boots, no boots, today the trend is with drones, so we will still be facing an issue the minute after. Al-Qaeda, for your information, is not completely defeated, okay? So it has been disrupted after the Afghanistan, you know, attacks, but they are still all over the place. What I'm worried about is the lack of structure of those groups. At least ISIS is identified now as a specific group that is targeting and threatening, you know, the West and some parts of the world very obviously. But how about these minute and tiny groups that are actually acting in Central Africa, in Mali, and so forth, and they actually recognize or affiliate themselves either to ISIS or to Al-Qaeda? If ISIS disappears, they will identify with whatever remains from Al-Qaeda, and if there's no Al-Qaeda, there will be something else. That's what I'm, that's my message. So back again to the political, I would say, response and the software. So what has happened in Europe, in parts of Europe, in Molenbeek, for example, mm-hmm. is 50 years of denial, okay? Politicians who have refused to recognize, or actors, some prominent actors who have refused to reckon that certain things were brewing. I was working in the 8th Division of the Brussels Police, which is in the north of Brussels. So I saw the Bakraoui brothers in shorts growing up in my neighborhood, okay? And then I met them when they were a little bit older, when they shot the SWAT team of the Brussels Police with a Kalashnikov after attacking an exchange office, small bank. Okay, so we chased them, and I was on watch. I remember that day in the winter time and for the general staff. So I went on the field with the chief of police and the special units, and guess who was hiding in a place, in a safe house? The Bakraoui brothers, after doing what they did, attacking the small bank and using the Kalashnikov. One politician said in French on TV, oh, this is just a fait divers. That's the expression in French. A fait divers is just like something you would say about somebody who stole, you know, a T-shirt in a Walmart shop, okay? Daily activity, criminal, small-time gangsters activity.
The Kalashnikov.
Of course.
Yeah.
And we said to some politicians, mind you, people like me, social workers, by the way, I always say that the best thermometers of society are police forces and the school system. If you want to know what happens in a neighborhood or in a city, ask the teachers. If you want to know more details, well, ask the cops. But if you're honest intellectually enough to give them the floor and allow them to speak their mind freely without threatening them with losing their promotion or something like that, like in some countries in the north of Europe where cops are actually scared about speaking. I mean, somebody like me speaking today would be basically retired at the end of the day, so to speak. So I remember being in Barcelona a few months ago for a conference about policing ethnic minorities, and my colleague from a country, so I will just preserve him, otherwise he will really be dead. He said, you know, in our environment, it's impossible to talk about certain topics. Which are the topics? Immigration, racism, anti-Semitism, and so forth. So some people have said these topics are extreme right topics. So the more you talk about it, you know, the more you get closer, you know, to extreme right parties. I say the other way around. I say if you don't talk about those topics, extreme right parties will take possession of those topics and make them their own topics. This is exactly what is happening in Europe. For example, at the very moment I'm speaking to you, we almost got a president in Austria who is actually a member of a Nazi party, at least an extreme right party funded by Nazi officers from the Second World War in the 50s. Believe it or don't believe it, it was about to happen 2 weeks ago. He lost by like a couple of thousands of votes, all right? Jobbik, for example, in Hungary, they are number two. Their ambition is to be number one next year. What is their topic? Immigration, terrorism, and so forth. But they are openly anti-Semitic. So these are the dangers. By not actually addressing certain issues, this is what I would like to pass as a message, is actually we are allowing other problems to develop in a dangerous fashion, like anti-Semitism and other parties. Look at what's happening in France. Marine Le Pen, okay, for those who know her, okay, her father said, I remember that because I've been following, you know, French politics for the last 25 years. One day on TV he said, the Shoah is a point of detail in history. C'est un point de détail. Okay? He became very famous for that. Well, his daughter is gaining 40% of the votes among the French public today in regional elections, that's 6 months ago, and other elections, and is about to be probably in the last step of the presidential elections next year. So this is the situation we found ourselves in today. I'll finish this sentence by saying intellectual honesty is a very important ingredient to introduce intellectual honesty in the way we approach certain topics. The politically correct, starting from today, should be dead and finished. My idea is that we should be able to talk about all topics, still not stigmatizing people, still respecting fundamental rights, and actually make the right diagnosis to, in the end, you know, approach the right solution. I think that is possible. Today, many people have said, no, you should not be talking about certain topics, end of the story. Well, we are paying a very heavy price for that. And it took 200 deaths, hundreds of maimed people. By the way, some of them are still about to die today in hospitals in Belgium. They're not, they're in dire situations. If you would see, you know, the terrible wounds that the Bakrawi brothers and their friends have inflicted on these people, it's horrible. I mean, doctors, I've seen doctors crying, surgeons who have actually seen all kinds of things in their career, but are still under shock today based on what I saw. It's like wartime kind of wounds. People penetrated by dozens of shrapnels, you know, deep in their body and experimenting some kind of infections that actually nobody can cure today. It's wartime kind of stuff. I've been in Malbec station, metro station, 45 minutes after the explosion. I cannot find the words to tell you, to describe what I've seen. I've seen people in bits and pieces in the subway station. I have pictures, I cannot show you the pictures. It's horrible. So this is the price that we have to pay today for our politically correct attitude, so to speak. So once again, we think.
Very powerful. Very grim and very powerful. And also points out the necessity of making common cause with allies in the immigrant communities who can work in
partnership
with you and with the political forces to defeat this menace.
Which brings me to the fourth element. You mentioned three elements. If I respectfully can add the fourth one, which is really addressing what we call in Brussels and in France, le vivre ensemble. For those who speak French around here, it's, let me translate it, it's the living together concept. As Yossi Klein Halevi pointed out yesterday, in the end, you know, the Jewish community has found a modus vivendi, you know, with the Catholics, all right? He mentioned that yesterday. So he said, okay, why not do it with the Muslims? Well, I say, yes, we have to. Actually, we are sentenced to find a way of actually living together in all those territories that we are talking about. Do you think it's normal? Well, I know the answer, but I'm just stating the question in a rhetoric fashion. It's normal to have, in 2016, Jewish citizens leaving France and Belgium and fleeing and finding or seeking refuge in other countries in the world. I think it's a totally collective failure. It's a horrible failure. Can we be happy about that? If some politicians in Europe can live with that, I can't. This is why voices are being raised more and more today. Respectfully, we are loyal, we are civil servants, we are ready to work in whatever reference framework politicians design for us. But there are limits as well. You want to see the Facebook pages of some cops or teachers, okay? For those who know France, the suburbs, you know, everybody's talking about Molenbeek today. It's one of the most famous, you know, places in the world. I've seen crews coming from, TV crews from New Zealand and so forth. In France, they have 400 portions of the territory that they call the lost, les territoires, the lost territories of the Republic. That means portions that are like small towns where the cops don't go anymore, okay? Law and order doesn't exist. Where, for your information, for those who have forgotten that, there was a Jewish French citizen, a young man, 25-year-old roughly, who has been kidnapped 5 years ago by a local gang from one of those lost territories of the Republic, and has been tortured and eventually killed. Do you remember that?
Ilan Halimi, 10 years ago.
Ilan Halimi, 10 years ago,
yes,
something like
yes,
that.
Indeed.
Okay, everybody has forgotten those things.
Yeah. Thank you. I want to make sure there's time for questions as well. So please store your questions. I just want another maybe bite or two at these guys. Will, you've analyzed ISIS probably more than anyone else on this planet. You wrote a piece in the Daily Beast not long ago, in which you lamented the lack of a coherent, effective communication strategy by the U.S. and our Western allies to defeat ISIS recruitment among alienated, disaffected youth. What is so compelling about ISIS recruitment media, and why is the Western response so inept?
You know, there's a lot of focus on ISIS's ability to reach out over social media and connect with young people, and it's true, they're very good at it, but actually one of their most effective pieces of propaganda is the most low-tech. It is an old-fashioned news magazine called Dabiq. Saad referred to it earlier. They distribute it online, but if you look at it, it's similar to Time magazine or Newsweek. It is a genre that was perfected in the West. They have taken it up. What makes it effective? If you look between its covers, what you see is a coherent and consistent explanation of what they are fighting for. They give detailed lists of every attack, and they explain how each attack fits into a larger strategy to reestablish the Islamic Empire and to expand its borders. In addition, they have sections on young people and commanders who are fighting for the organization, the sacrifices that they are making to rebuild God's kingdom on earth. When you look at the other side and how the coalition messages, it's non-existent. We say bad things about Dabiq, but we're not very good at explaining what we are fighting for, why we are carrying out these attacks, where we are carrying out these attacks. If you try to find numbers and explanations of all of the ordnance and bombs that have been dropped in Iraq and Syria, there's a single web page on the DOD, the Department of Defense's website, and it gives you raw numbers of sorties flown and bombs dropped. You get no sense of where we are fighting and why. When the United States talks about Russian intervention in Syria, it's very good at explaining why the Russians are there, and it gives you detailed maps of where the bombs are falling, why the Russians are dropping the bombs in those locations. When it comes to what the coalition is doing, there is no such explanation, and it's a real contrast with how we message with regards to other conflicts and how we've messaged previously, say in the 1990s during the Gulf War. The reason is that, number one, the United States wants it to look as if its partners in the coalition are spearheading the fighting, particularly in Iraq. It is trying to keep that government on side. It doesn't want to take a share of the limelight. You also have to understand that the media environment is very different than in the 1990s. Every single thing the United States says is heavily scrutinized by the press, and also, as a consequence, by the Congress. And there are a number of legal limitations as to what the United States can say. The other side is not constrained in its reporting the way the United States is. All of those factors, very mundane, bureaucratic, political considerations, conspire and come together to make the message from the United States side and the coalition side anemic in comparison with that of the Islamic State.
Ronen, talk about the ISIS threat directly to Israel and how Israel responds to that threat, and also a little bit about the, I don't know if I want to say partnership, but the dialogue that exists between Israel and Russia regarding what's happening in Syria.
As a journalist, I wouldn't like to destroy a good headline and maybe diminish the drama. But I think that the threat of ISIS to Israel is by far exaggerated. If we view the main security challenge that Israel faced for the last 40 years, until 5 years ago, the main military challenge was the Syrian army, based on the northern border of Israel, some 500,000 troops, armed to the teeth with advanced Soviet weapon, and has the capability to launch chemical agents all over Israel, including VX, which is the most lethal one. This doesn't exist anymore. Syrian army disassembled, stretched all over the country trying to fight the rebels, etc. Chemical weapon doesn't exist, or most of it, the storage doesn't exist anymore. In the past, the Syrian military had the capability to harm Israel, and the horrific scenario was that the Syrian army and the Iraqi army were just with 53 armed divisions, which just start marching towards Israel. This doesn't exist anymore. They had the capability of harming Israel, but they had nothing to do with France or Britain. They had no ability to harm them. Today, ISIS, with the Toyota pickup, doesn't have the capability to harm Israel, but as we heard, has a profound capability to harm France or Belgium or Britain or Germany. So there's a security challenge there, but I think it's far more smaller than we used to have. The biggest security challenge in the area is still Hezbollah, by far. Hezbollah is a strategic, not an existential, but a strategic threat to Israel. Its capabilities now at the use of President Assad fighting ISIS and the rebels, but still preparing for the next confrontation with Israel, together with Hamas and both organizations, military and missile capability. These are the main security challenges. Though, at the same time, Israel is trying to keep some track over ISIS and Al-Qaeda in Syria and Iraq, but the main threat, as much as they pose, is to Israeli and Jewish target outside of Israel. If you view the Magna Carta of the Israeli intelligence foreign intelligence organization, the Mossad, you'll see that this is an unprecedented list of targets. One of them, which is uncomparable to any other organization in the world, is to defend Jews around the world, not just Israelis, to defend Jews around the world. Israel sees itself as responsible for the faith and the security of Jews worldwide, not just in word, but in action. So ISIS as Al-Qaeda in the past, is almost not trying to work inside Israel, but they are trying, and Al-Qaeda did, the bombing of the synagogue in Tunisia, Israeli targets in Mombasa, and many others incidents. And ISIS is trying to look for intelligence that would enable its operatives to work against Israeli and Jewish targets worldwide, including mainly Europe, of course. This is a threat that Israel should deal with. And I think, I hope, I believe that Israel is taking this threat as serious as it should.
Talk a little bit again about, before I get to you, back to Saad, the issue of Russia-Israel cooperation.
Yeah, look, the Prime Minister Netanyahu is now in a visit to Moscow. It's the fourth visit in the last year and a half. Unprecedented number when it comes to Israeli-Russian relations. I think that Prime Minister Netanyahu is trying to make a sort of a demonstration and show the world that Israel has some other potential alliance with another superpower. I don't see, of course, any kind of situation where Russia adopts Israel to be its main ally in the area. This is, you know, in another world. But still, Prime Minister Netanyahu, and in that sense he's right, is trying to make some sort of security coordination between Israel and Russian intelligence and Russian military. And so far, it worked. The Russians are not bombing the rebels in the Golan Heights, therefore not getting too close to Israeli troops. And Israel was not bombing, and Israel is launching repeated attacks in Syria and Lebanon, trying to avoid the shipments of arms from Syria to Hezbollah, right, and also targeted killing some of the prominent activists of Hezbollah in Syria. And Israel refrained from doing that next to Russian troops. God forbid that Israel would take down a Russian plane.
Right.
We know what happened with Turkey or killing a Russian soldier. At the time being, it worked, and to a limited extent, the military coordination on a tactical level, I think it's a good sign for the possibility of improving the relations between Israel and Russia. Saying that, Russian main ally in the area are Iran and Syria. It's not Israel, and right, no one should be confused about that.
Thank you for clarifying that. You wanted to jump inside quickly, and then we'll take questions.
Yeah,
please.
On the issue of, which I think is really critical, on the issue of putting forward a message to counter, actually a counter-narrative to what Daesh says. I think it's not very effective even if we get to refine our message and so forth, it poses two issues. The first one is the issue of legitimacy, okay? So it's like, as I was working in the criminal investigative branch, we always try to put ourselves in the shoes of the criminals and try to understand their rationality to actually be able to counter whatever they do. So here in this case, we have to put ourselves in the shoes of those who are behind the very effective, you know, strategy, communication strategy of Daesh. Just to tell you that whatever messages we put on Twitter, on Facebook, whatever campaign we do, it will never, ever be efficient enough to actually counter what Daesh is trying to funnel to our youngsters in Europe. I think the best strategy is to empower the mothers and the parents of those youngsters. This is just an image. That means, that brings me to the next step of the strategy, is actually to empower the mainstream, positive, constructive Muslim community, as Yossi Halevi said yesterday, with whom we can build an alliance to actually defeat those folks. Because the young guy who is living in Molenbeek, for example, when he goes on his computer and checks, you know, messages from Daesh, who's going to make sure that actually he is refusing this message? His surrounding, his environment, his teacher, his mother. You know that mothers have a tremendous impact on youngsters, especially in Molenbeek. There is an association, a very effective one, of mothers that nobody has paid attention to, but they can be very effective. You know, the local imams, if we have the right folks, they can be extremely effective into telling those youngsters, beware, the message of Daesh is full of crap. You know, don't pay attention to that, don't go to Syria. So they will not actually pay attention to a message coming from the White House or coming from any Western institution. Last comment, you mentioned Dabiq, right? You know that there is a French-speaking, you know, version called Dar al-Islam. This one, I don't know if you can read French, this one is really effective. You know, this the really refined, written by a guy. I mean, not a mistake, you know, in the wording and the reference framework, back to what I said earlier, that they're using appeals to mainstream Muslims. You know, an old mother, if she reads that stuff, if somebody reads that stuff for her, she will feel some form of connection, you know, with that message. And I will give you just one small detail, because they're using a Daesh. Remember Sykes-Picot? Everybody knows Sykes-Picot agreements? Okay, they're using that in their clips and in the magazine. For those who love history, because history can help us actually understand and design, you know, the strategies of the future, remember Lawrence of Arabia, okay? In the good old days of Lawrence of Arabia, you have France and England. I'm just trying to be the advocate of the devil, right? To understand, you know, what Daesh is saying. They designed a region with borders that are totally artificial. Everybody who is, once again, intellectually honest can actually acknowledge that. They draw lines. They even digital footage of that today, qualitative digital footage. I saw it, by the way, on National Geographic not long ago, when you have a French officer, old-fashioned, you know, with a British officer, designing borders that are extremely straightforward and not taking into account that here you have Shiites, that here you have Kurds, and so forth. This has been partly, I'm not saying this is an excuse, but it has been partly at the origin of the rationale that Daesh is being is putting forward. And to counter that, it's extremely difficult. So we are left with one solution, which is the grassroots, the mothers, the mainstream communities that we will have to empower in the future.
Ronen, I think we just celebrated an anniversary of Sykes-Picot, so please.
Two quick points on recruitment. The first, the Turkish police has arrested many young people coming from all over the world and were on their way to Syria and Iraq. And in the possession of some of them, they found a small booklet called Islam for Dummies. It's like wine for dummies. Like, now, what is, except for being a bit funny, but except for the anecdote, what is the meaning of that? The meaning is that these people had no idea about Islam prior to coming. before coming.
It's about the fight, not about
That was about the fight. That was about the larger purpose. There's a MIT professor who claims that there's also the promise to have the sort of sexual life that they don't have in Europe. They feel sexually frustrated. They don't have. They see their friends or their the teenagers, Western teenagers, that they do have this kind of sexual life. They don't have. They are inferior to others, etc. They come. They don't have a clue about Islam. Their comrades back in Syria, they say, "Well, have at least a look at Islam for dummies, so you'll know something when you come over, and you know you won't be completely dumb." So this is one. The second, it was mentioned here, your cooperation with the Moroccan police. The United Nations have adopted some of the ideas in Morocco, how to train the imams of the mosques.
Yeah.
They have a very clear process of scrutiny and training of imams, and very strict one. Only imam that advocates ideas of civil rights, of peace, etc., anti-terrorism, etc., and passes along a very long way of recruitment and training will be given the authority of an imam. The United Nations, the Security Council headquarters for counterterrorism, trying to imply the same program for many other countries. This is one of the, it's only one, but one good solution that could help preventing the ability to recruit new
Will, trainees. To what extent are Arab states working on this aspect, this counter-radicalization aspect, in partnership with the United States and our allies? Are they true partners in the effort to de-radicalize, to counter the radical formula?
Depends which Arab nation you're talking about. Morocco is the best example of a very good partner. Saudi Arabia is probably an example of the worst one, and then you find a range in the middle. I mean, the Saudis have been proselytizing outside of the kingdom for decades, spreading a version of Islam that is in many ways indistinguishable from the kind of Islam that's practiced by ISIS. In particular, they encourage hatred towards the infidels and towards Muslims who don't think like them. It's a doctrine.
As long as they don't touch Saudi Arabia.
It is a doctrine that is inherent in Wahhabism, and they have been spreading it around the world, in Europe, in South Asia, Southeast Asia, and it is coming back to bite them and to bite the rest of us. So they have a real challenge on their hands, because the royals that rule Saudi Arabia do so on the basis of this deal they made with the religious establishment, and it is very hard for them to walk away from the spread of this ideology and not lose their own legitimacy. So they have the toughest road to walk, but I think there's a lot of promising signs outside of the kingdom, particularly Morocco.
Thank you. Okay, now, I totally dominated this, and I apologize to the audience, but let's take some questions from the audience. We have time for maybe 15 minutes, I think, of that. Yes, please. First question. Please identify yourself. Thank you.
My name is Jonathan Heuberger from the Institute for National Security Studies in Israel. This is a fascinating panel. Thank you. Two short questions. Number one, how does ISIS finance itself? Ronen, you mentioned the Toyota pickups. Maybe you can elaborate on that. Where's the money coming from? Are they walking around with cash and so on? And the second question is, you mentioned the ideology of ISIS, and what would be the role of social media companies in eradicating that ideology, like YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter? Are there any legal means? What would be the right steps in this direction?
Let's take a couple of questions together. Yes, I think one back here.
And my question, Mamie Day and Vogel from Atlanta, it's a piggyback question on that. Are there any public policy institutions or private sector organizations that you're working with or know of that are trying to combat all of the basically strong and effective marketing and advertising that Daesh is putting out there to try to reach the same demographics and the same populace that you know of?
Thank you. Question over here, yes, please. Yes, yes, you, ma'am.
Okay. My question is...
Wait for the microphone, please, and identify yourself.
My name is Renee Lemberg. I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio. And I used to be an educator for many years. My question to the police chief, you got the most applause when you talked about stemming things early on without having to worry about about stereotyping people or, you know, any little minute thing. And how do you go? You're telling an audience, we like to think we're in our prime, but many of us are past prime. How do you get to the college campuses and the young people to talk about the ideologies you mentioned?
Okay, I think maybe just one more question. Yes, please, you, sir.
My name's Hank Citron. I'm from New York City. There's been a great deal of talk of a regional coalition, that's in quotes, among Egypt, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, and of course Israel. A lot of talk has been going on. Would you comment on that?
Okay, let's start with that, and if we are somehow miraculously have more time, we'll extend this. Who would like to start out with how ISIS financed itself? I think, Will, that's probably best for you. How does it
sure.
finance?
Yeah, well, it's mainly self-financed. It made a decision early in its history, going back to when it was previously Al-Qaeda in Iraq, to mainly raise money from local sources, usually from kidnapping and extortion. Even when the organization was defeated in the late 2000s, it was still raising something on the level of $250 million a year from kidnapping and extortion. This is a group that is extremely good at financing itself. It did not want to be subject to the kind of sanctions and countermeasures that Al-Qaeda faced because of its sources, its funding sources, private funding sources in the Gulf. Today, it controls something between $1 and $2 billion. Because of the oil it has, most of its money comes from tax revenues. So the more you shrink its control of territory, the more difficulty it will have in financing itself.
Ronen, maybe I could ask you about this last question about regional coalition, Israel in partnership with Arab states in defeating ISIS and defeating extremism in general. Partnership between Israel and its neighbors?
I think that in current times, until the Palestinian dispute is resolved, inshallah, tomorrow, maybe the day after tomorrow, but in any case, until that happens, the regional alliance should be, or is done in secret, of course. Much of that, the Sunni moderate countries cannot publicly say that they are cooperating with Israel, the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Jordan, let me say this. When time comes and secret files are open, in 50 years or so, I think people are going to be amazed, shocked even, by the extent, the gravity, and how profound, intimate even, the security and intelligence cooperation was during these years. The man who, I would say, grasped the situation as it is 12, 15 years ago was then the chief of the Mossad, Meir Dagan, who perished 2 months ago. He understood that while condemning Israel and taking a hostile point of view towards Israel in the overt sphere, there are many organizations and countries that basically seize the interest and the area more or less like Israel. All of them despise Hamas. They hate the Alawite regime in Syria. And they are afraid more than anything else, even more than Israel, that Iran would get a nuclear bomb. And on that basis, Mossad, Meir Dagan, and Mossad were able to create secret connections with moderate regimes in the area. And without getting into details, also not to a spoiler to my book on Mossad, but I can tell you that much of the successes that were attributed to Israeli intelligence in the last 15 years could not have happened if it were not local regimes helping Israel do the work. The blanket is small, the budget is small, the cake is, it cannot, Israel cannot compete with everything. Based on these mutual interests, intelligence cooperation yield to unbelievable successes.
Well, there's more openly acknowledged cooperation with Egypt, for instance, in controlling this threat in the Sinai.
Of course, the Philadelphia route and everything happening there. But there's even more to say about how Israel is helping the Egyptian, trying to fight Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis, the Sinai provenance of ISIS in Sinai, using, again, the same techniques, the same technology that Israel is using to fight, used to use in order to fight suicide terrorism.
Saad, there were questions about working on college campuses and trying to defeat this ideology among the next generation, and also the degree to which social media has been exploited or can be exploited to or used to counter this these messages?
Of course, it can be exploited. But once again, you have to put it in a global perspective. We have to have a comprehensive approach. I will repeat it again and again. Just doing some surgical interventions on improving this or improving that, we need to have a vision based on values and deal with what the Moroccan police, back again, said, the last pillar, the third one, the restructuring of the religious pillar, even if the youngsters who are leaving to Syria are not specialists, and I can confirm what you said about the Islam for Dummies kind of story, because we have been confronted with that as well. But they are bathing in a global environment. So Molenbeek, for example, or other neighborhoods in Europe are not about being specialists about Islam. No, these youngsters are definitely not specialists, but they are bathing in a global wave of negative talk, hatred, hate speeches, and so forth that actually facilitate, you know, the next step of saying, okay, now maybe it's time for me to go. One of the last pieces of advice from the Moroccan terror branch police was, there is no such thing as lone wolves who radicalize in their bedroom alone. They can start doing it, but at some point, there is always a human contact. That human contact can be the local recruiter, and Daesh has a lot of recruiters, you know, patrolling, you know, these neighborhoods, these weak neighborhoods, where people are, as you put it out, you know, just what I would call intellectually disequipped, you know, in terms of analyzing, you know, all this, the negative speech and the rationale that they're being confronted with. And on the other hand, the mosques or the network of fathers and mothers. Let me just finish on that example. He said, the boss of that Moroccan police team, because we visited different cities in Belgium. One of them was Antwerp, and the other one was Verviers, where we actually neutralized a team of Daesh a year and a half ago. He went to the mosque, and he said, the only thing you have to do when you go into a mosque is not talk to the imam or ask him what he thinks and so forth. Just take a look at the library. That brings me back to what my honorable colleague here on the left said. The software, what I call the software. You know, the books, the places where the books were edited, you know, can tell a lot about the kind of talk that the imam will share with the audience. And if that young lad who has been reading Islam for Dummies in a book, at some point he goes into a mosque or he goes in a cafe where old folks will be talking to him and so forth, and at some point they will encourage him or not encourage him to do certain things. And this is exactly that gray zone that we should actually embrace and give an alternative to that. That can be combined, madam, you know, with working on campuses and working on social media. And when you speak about campuses, thank you very much for this comment. That gives me an opportunity to say we have to invest on mainstream Muslim community and their intelligentsia. Okay, up until now, one of the mistakes that have been made in Europe is every time something happens, riots, problems, what do the local politicians do? They actually call the local imam, who sometimes can't even speak the national language, okay, and try to negotiate with him and ask him for advice and tell him to actually quell whatever small revolt or riot is taking place and so forth. We have actually worked with the wrong partners. Now, we have to change the paradigm. This is one of my messages. And by changing the global paradigm, it's a multidisciplinary approach, different elements that have to be taken into account. One of them is choosing the right partners. Once again, I'm relating to what Yossi Halevi said yesterday. We have to build bridges, you know, with the Muslim community. Well, the only message of hope that I can share with you today is that there is a silent majority which is scared. By the way, tomorrow I'll be in New York with my friend Jonathan working on a pilot project that we will start in downtown Brussels with the Jewish community and also in Molenbeek. We chose two vulnerable communities And we are being helped by advisors from Homeland Security and from the Rutgers University. So really out of the box, innovative approach, and we will bring together all those communities at some point. Why are we considering Muslims in Molenbeek as vulnerable community? Well, when we did an exploratory mission, and I'm closing on that one, with the team from Rutgers, the deputy mayor of Molenbeek, who is Muslim, by the way, Michel Canus, he said to us something that I knew before, that a lot of people have been terrorized intellectually and mentally by a certain number of families, like the Abaoud family, for those who remember, you know, the head of the team that did this havoc in Paris, and the other families from Salah Abdeslam and so forth. They were so strong, so vocal, and so aggressive that the rest of the mainstream families were scared to actually talk, share the intelligence with the police, be vocal themselves and tell them to stop with their nonsense and so forth. So the idea is to empower those folks to actually win against the dark forces. This, I think, is the right strategy because it's interesting in the sense that it's durable, okay? It's gonna help us build the other bridges that we are all longing for, which is in the end, very basically, having all the communities, you know, live together with mutual respect in all security, okay? Like we have experienced that many years ago in different countries. History has told us that it is possible. It is difficult, but it is possible.
Thank you, sir. Well, I'd like to close with you. We're looking at the end of the Obama administration in 6 months, and looking ahead to the possibility of changing the U.S. strategy toward ISIS. If you were advising the next president of whichever party, what would you suggest in terms of perhaps a different approach to countering this menace?
I think what we're doing in Syria and Iraq is about all we can do, given the constraints. I think the major gaps are, one, better coordination, particularly of intelligence in Europe. This is one reason why so many have been able to infiltrate back through and carry out attacks. And then the second would be coming up with a plan for what to do about the other countries where groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda are going to go. This is the big part of the strategy that's missing. And in particular, even when we are successful at defeating those groups, who comes in to stabilize those areas to make sure that they're not going to return? This is the big policy challenge for the next administration.
Thank you very much. Will and Ronen and Saad, this has been a fascinating discussion. I thank you all very much.